Hey, another great 10 Essential video. This will be the final exam review. This will be part one. This will be mainly the multiple choice stuff. Some of these questions will look remarkably similar to the midterm stuff, but, you know, the numbers might change. Here we go. Next slide. All right, so there's the standard rules. Use your single sheet course reference notes, your cheat sheet that you have prepared. All right. I'll allow you to use, well, yes, use. You are expected to have your own single cheat sheet, well, reference notes. Use a calculator to its full effect. Wink, wink. If you need it to do fractions, then use it to do. If you've got a fraction button on your calculator, use it. If you don't like doing fractions, I don't care, but you probably don't want to get a job in the trades if you can't do fractions. Conversion factors, I will always provide you, you know, how many pounds per kilogram, etc. Geometric formulas, I will always give those to you as well, areas and circumferences. So when you're doing this multiple choice, pick the best or closest answer. You know, sometimes I don't nail them bang on, sometimes I use a different value for pi or something. So pick the best or closest answer. Use an accurate value for pi in this particular thing. I know some of the worksheets we did, we said to use 3.14, right? 3.14. But it turns out that, you know, 3.14 is only just close. Sometimes you use 3.14, sometimes you use 22 over 7, but you do have a button on your calculator that has pi. So unless I say otherwise, use the pi button on your calculator. Where is it? Oh, there it is right there on mine. So use the real value of, or the more accurate value of pi. Each question is 2 marks. Show your work. If you don't show your work and all you do is whip an answer down, I can't even give you part marks. All right? So show, well, you can't show your work for multiple choice. I'm sorry. But show your work when it comes to the open response part in part two. Remember to eliminate the dumb answers. Often in multiple choice, there's like one, sometimes two, sometimes three, dumb answers. Don't pick the dumb. Use some common sense. It is possible to pass a multiple choice test and have no clue what you're doing if the teacher's being really nice. All right, next slide. All right, so there's how we organize stuff. All right, you might find out that there's a couple units that we had left out. Depends on the class. Sometimes because of attendance or things or weather, we end up leaving out a unit or two. Often I end up leaving out the trig unit, which is bad, in favor of the upgrade type stuff, you know, especially at the beginning of a year when we got to practice our multiplying and dividing and, you know, making sure people can do some fractions. So often I leave out the trigonometry. Well, that's good because you do trig again in grade 11 and in grade 12. Often I leave out this angle construction. That's using, you know, like the dividers and the rulers and measuring things, all right, making angles. All right, but other than that, yes, so sometimes I even leave out a little bit of consumer, but that's just proportions, you know. So like if 2 rolls of toilet paper is $3.60, then 1 roll is $1.80. So it's, if you knew proportions from the measurement, then the consumer unit's pretty much the same thing. All right, so if you discover there's something on here you don't know, that may be because you didn't get a chance to do it or I left it out. All right, let's start with this. 6.45% of 1,325. Well, you know what? The first thing to do is kind of look at dumb answers. I don't really see any dumb well, yeah, this one's kind of a dumb answer. I would kind of guess at this. I would say that 6.45 is kind of like 5%. And 5% means 5 per 100 of. And I'd say that's 1,300. I just kind of use round numbers. So 5 out of 100. Well, let's see. The hundreds would cancel. So that would be like, I'm thinking the answer somewhere around, I don't know, what's 5 times 13? Somewhere around 65 is the answer. So it's definitely not this one, right? So just using a little bit of estimating, it's definitely not that one, right? And this one sounds a little bit too high because I'm kind of expecting an answer somewhere in the 60s maybe, right? But it's going to be a little higher. in any event, because I rounded this down, so it's not that answer, in other words, is what I'm saying, all right? So I like to sometimes estimate and round things. Now let's do the real math, all right? So 6.45% is French for per hundred. If you do not write your fractions like this, you are absolutely nuts. Of means multiply, 1,325. So you put that in your plastic brain. You can go 6.45 divided by 100 times 1,325, or you can go 6.45 times 1,325 divided by 100. If you're just multiplying and dividing, nobody cares what order you do it in, all right? So it doesn't really matter. Let's get my plastic brain here. Okay, I typed it into my plastic brain, 6.45 for every 100 times. Sometimes the times looks like an asterisk depending on your computer, 1,325. Boom! 8546. There's no rounding up or anything. 85. Hey, look at that. There's the answer. All right, so that one was pretty straightforward. Okay, Mathilde gets paid an hourly rate. Now, a rate is a comparison of two numbers, dollars per hour. So it's $13 for every 1 hour. That's what a rate means. A rate means you're comparing two things. So this is dollars for every 1 hour. She works the following hours in 1 week. What is her gross pay? If she gets time and a half after 8 hours in any one day. All right, so let's think about this first. First of all, if you worked an entire week for $162, I'm kind of thinking that's probably not the answer. Right? Who the heck would work an entire week for $162? A little common sense says that's probably not going to work. All right? Well, it might have been like a part-time job, I suppose. All right? But let's do the hours now. Let's add them up. So let's look at the regular hours, and let's look at the overtime hours. Regular, overtime. Okay, I populated the regular hours, 7, the first 8. 5, the first 8 of that is that, so that means there's no overtime that day. There's 2 hours overtime on Tuesday. There's no overtime on Wednesday. There's 2 hours of overtime on Thursday, and there's no hours of overtime there. Let's do the totals. All right, so I'm thinking the totals are, so when you add that up, that's 32. All right, so there's 15, 20, and 12 makes 32, and the overtime hours are going to be 4. All right. So how much money is this person going to make? Well, they're going to make 32 hours at the regular rate, 32 times, so 32 hours. I like to show units. That way you know you can't mess it up. Times $13.50, that's what a rate is. It's how much per something else per 1 hour. Notice how the units will cancel out. Hey, you're left with the units you're looking for. So that's the regular pay. How about the overtime pay? The overtime pay is going to be, well, it's going to be 4 hours. And that's going to be at a rate of, well, you get $13.50 per hour times 1.5. Actually, it's really the time that gets multiplied by 1.5, but most people multiply the money by 1.5. It sounds better. All right, so they're really getting $19.75 for their pay. Is that right? Well, so that'd be really 20 and a quarter per hour. Anyway, let's do the math. So I put it in there, 32 hours at $13.50 per every 1 hour ends up being the units of money, and my calculator says that's $432. And this was hours, and this was dollars per hour. So, right, so that's going to be, let's do that on the calculator, 13.5. Oh, I'm sorry, how about 4 hours times 13.5. Now, I don't need the brackets there, times 1.5. They're just there to identify things. That's going to be $81, and you're going to add them all together. And what's that work out to be? 513 dollars. So your pay, your gross pay, is going to be 513. Oh, look at that! It's one of the answers, right? So clearly that was a dumb answer, and this one sounded a little bit high. So chances are you only had the two choices there. Even if you didn't know how to calculate this, the most reasonable answers were those ones, maybe. All right, next slide. All right, Brian has a gross income of $572 a week. He contributes $45 per week to an RRSP, a registered retirement savings plan. It's a good idea to save money. If you could put away $45 a week for like 35 or 40 years of working, oh my goodness, you probably have $500,000. All right, so man, that would be a lot of money. Oh, I just did a little bit of fancy math on my computer here, and you'll get to do this in applied math. But if you put away $45 a week for 2080 payments, so that's 40 years of working. So if you work for 40 years and put away $45 a week at 5% interest, you'll have $298,000. You'll have almost $300,000 in the bank. All you got to do is put away 45 bucks a week. Anyway, we don't do that until we'll do that in grade 12 applied. Anyway, so what is the answer to this? So Brian has a gross income. Okay, so you got a formula. Hopefully this is on your cheat sheet that the income tax you pay. So this is the income tax you pay because there are other types of tax you pay, you know. All right, you pay tax when you earn your money. You pay tax when you spend your money. You pay tax when you die, when you buy gas, when you whatever. Anyway, so as far as income tax is concerned, the income tax you pay is equal to your taxable income. Well, remember the taxable is you take your 572 gross and you subtract the 45. The Queen doesn't make you pay taxes on the $45. So let's do that. What's 572? So the Queen wants you to put money away. So your taxable income is 527. All right. So the income tax you're going to pay is 527. That's your taxable income. Then you pay a proportion of that. And I said you're going to pay 22%. That's about right for somebody in that income tax bracket. Don't forget percent is per hundred. All right, let's see you do that on the calculator. So you got the 527, and you're going to multiply that by 22, and you're going to divide that by 100, and that will be your income tax, $115.94. Look at that. There's the answer right there. All right, now let's use some common sense. Obviously, I hope you think it's obvious. Obviously, it wasn't that. Right? If you think that you can pay for everything that Canada gives you for $9.90, you know, everything you get for free, then that would be crazy. If you think you're going to pay if you think you're going to earn 572 and you have to pay 527, what the heck are you working for, right? You wouldn't be bothering, right? So it's pretty clear that that was dumb and that was dumb. So these two were contenders for the proper answer, all right? We came up with 115.94. All right, next slide. Here we go. The sum of two numbers is 14. Their difference is 5. Find the two numbers. Now, this is a good case for using a secret thing called back solving or just test your answer. Just test each one and see which one works. All right, so let's test. We want two numbers that add up to 7, but their difference, right, difference means subtract, is 5. So their absolute value and their difference is 5. So let's see. 7 plus 7 is 14. Hey, that works. I like it. But 7 minus 7, oh no, that's wrong. That equals 0. All right, so that's obviously not going to work. So that's not the answer. How about 14 and 9? Right? 14 plus 9, that's not right. The sum has to be 14. So that's not even right to start with. How about 7 and 12? 7 plus 12 is 19, so the sum the sum has to be 14, so that's not right either. So you're kind of going, well, if none of those is right, I'm thinking this one might be good. What's 9.5 plus 4.5? Right, you kind of used elimination there. I'm thinking that's really going to equal 14. Hey, that's looking good. I like it. And what is their difference? Difference means subtract. What's 9.5 minus 4.5? And you'd say, well, the answer's 4. Hey, oh, I'm sorry. The answer's not 4. The answer's 5. Hey, so you satisfy both of those. That is your answer. All right. So this is called back solving. Back solving means you test all the possible answers. You're only given 4 choices. You eliminate the 3 choices by testing them to see if they work. It's called back solve. In other words, you test each answer. It's another secret way to solve multiple choice. You test which ones are wrong, and whatever's left over is right. All right? So test the answers, each answer. All right? So there are secret ways to pass multiple choice exams, just using a bit of common sense and a little strategy. All right, Derek gets paid $16.50 per hour. That's a rate, dollars per hour. He works the following hours. What's his gross pay if overtime is paid? Time and a half after 40 hours in a week. So this isn't like the previous one. This isn't if you work more than 8 hours in a day. This is 40 hours in a week. So let's do the numbers here. Okay, so I got, what have I got here? I've got, this is easy. 8 and 12 is 20, and that makes 30. And the 9 and the 4 makes 13. So I'm thinking that's 43. All right, notice how I like to add whatever is easiest in my head. So I'm thinking that's 43. Let me just check that again. 18, 27, 39, and 4 makes 43 hours. All right. So obviously, if he works 43 hours, after 40, he gets overtime. So he gets 40 regular. All right. That's his regular pay. And he makes 3 hours overtime. All right. Overtime hours. So this is his hours. His overtime hours is going to be 3 hours. Now let's multiply by his rate. So 40 hours at $16.50 an hour, $16.5 per hour. Everybody loves the unit of dollars, and it's a rate, so it's a per something per hour. And this one's going to be 3 hours, and the rate of pay is going to be $16.50 per hour. But you're going to multiply that by 1.5. And if we do all the fancy math there, what do we end up with? All right, let's find his regular pay and his overtime pay. Okay, so, I just got the plastic brain to do it there, okay? So I ended up with $734.25. So I end up, when I do all that, what did it say here? This ended up being 600. And you get to use this fancy computer calculator when you get the grade 12 applied. Plus 74.25. I think I did it right. Anyway, I said in the instructions to pick the closest answer, didn't I? So don't go telling me that the answer's not there, because quite clearly I said in the beginning, pick the closest answer. That's just my way of testing if you read instructions. So nobody cares about the quarter that you're missing. 734.25. So don't forget, when I tell you to pick the best or the closest answer, maybe I just rounded to the nearest dollar, because maybe we don't pay in quarters. Next slide. Jason has a $485 taxable income. He pays $135 in taxes, income taxes, that is. What is his combined provincial and federal tax? Well, didn't we say we had a secret formula for that? So there's the secret formula. The income tax you pay is your taxable income times the tax rate. And so now you plug in, you write down the formula, then you plug in the numbers. All right, so the income, he pays $135. His taxable income was $485 times the rate. And you're going, how do I do that? Well, you could guess until you get the right answer. But remember how to do that from proportions and things, right? You could say, well, that's really the same as that. How do you get rid of that number there? Don't you pop it in underneath? So you would just solve backwards, right? What happened before you multiplied this number by 485? If you unmultiply by 485, isn't that the same as dividing? So it turns out your answer is going to be, your rate is going to be, this is really called algebra, by the way. So it's 135 over 485. And you'd put that in your plastic brain. All right, 135 over 485. Where are you? Let's clear that out. 135 divided by 485. And you'd end up with this. Boom. 0.27835. Let's just call it 0.28. 0.28. Which, of course, if you turn that into a percent, don't you go boom, boom, right? That says 28 one-hundredths, doesn't it? And 28 one-hundredths is the same as 28 per hundred, which we call 28% in French. There you go. So 0.28 is the same thing as 28%. All right, so, yeah, you had to actually unmultiply by the 485. And how did you get rid of that 485 when we did proportions? Didn't you pop it down underneath to the other side? Right? Or all you're doing is you're really just working it backwards. What was this number here before you multiplied by 485? So you unmultiply by 485, which is called dividing. We'll do lots more of that. It's called algebra. If you don't like algebra, well, you know what? Whatever. Next slide. All right, there's three pizzas. Three pizzas and a Coke. $4.50 for the 2-liter Coke. The total is $40.50. There's no tax. All right, let's not confuse things with the tax. Besides, it's food, although I think you pay tax on Coke now. Whatever. Who knows what they tax anymore? They change it every year anyways. All right, so you got three pizzas, one, two, three, and a 2-liter of Coke is $40.50. Well, one way you can solve any problem on the planet is to guess and check. So let's do a guess and check. Are you ready? Here we go. Well, first of all, you notice straight away that this answer here, 13%, is dumb. All right? And look at this. I have units there and units there, and I didn't put any units there. So is this 13.5 pesos, 13.5 cents, 13.5 pickles, 13.5 cruzeiros in Brazil? It didn't say what the units were. So chances are this isn't right either, unless the teacher was screwed up. So it's got to be one of those two, doesn't it? Okay, that's called using a little bit of common sense and being tactical and strategic. All right. Now, maybe I forgot to put the dollar sign on there, so whatever. All right, so let's guess. Let's guess the price of pizza is $10. All right, so $10. Let's see. So one pizza is 10, so three pizzas would be 30. And then if you added the $4.50, that would be a total of, right, what would the total be? The total would be, let's see if that is the right price. Total would be 44.50. No, we're trying to make it come to 40.50. That's too high. All right, too high. Too high. So obviously a pizza costs three pizzas abort. Whiskey Tango Hotel, what was I saying? That's not $44.50, that's $34.50. It helps if you know how to add, right? So that's too high. All right, so let's try a little higher. So then we try, well, let's try 15. Notice I skillfully left a blank there. So that would be, if one pizza is 15, then three pizzas would be 45. This is called guessing and checking, all right? You guess and check, and you make it all in a nice little table to keep track of what you're doing. Guess and check. Guessing and checking will always, always work. It might take you hours and hours to come up with the answer, but it will always work. And then you add the 450 for the Coke, and that's going to be 60, and another 450 is going to 64.50. Oh, that's too much. We're trying to make it, right? This one was too low, and this one is too high. So we know the answer is somewhere in between, we think. All right, so let's guess at, let's guess at 12, because it's one of the answers. Well, you already kind of figured it out, didn't you? It's kind of got to be that one. All right, so if one pizza's 12, two pizzas would be 36, and then another 450, add the 450 would be a total of, what's that going to add up to? 12 and 30, yeah, 36 and 450 is going to be, the three pizzas is 36, the four, that'll be $40.50. Hey, that's what we were looking for. All right, so that's right on. So it turns out the answer is 12. So 12 is the one that when you triple it and add 450 gives you the 40.50. There is the answer, $12. And we did that by guessing and checking, and we did it in a nice kind of, we kept track of our guesses and the result. All right, this guess and check will always, always work. It might take you years to come up with the answer, but you can always guess and check in an equation. And that assumes there's only one answer. What if there's, yes, let's not go there. Okay, next slide. All right, now the other thing you could have done was you could have just done reverse engineer, solve it backwards. In other words, undo what was done. All right, so what I'm saying here, say the three pizzas and the Coke is 40.50. All right, so in other words, what happens if we got rid of the Coke? What if you said, oh, I don't have enough money, you're going to have to take away that Coke. All right, so let's take away the Coke. So if I took away the Coke, Now, how much money did you spend? All right, if you took away the Coke, that wouldn't be $40.50 anymore. It'd be $4.50 less, so it'd be $36, wouldn't it? No. So all we did was we undid what we did. We took away the Coke. Now we know that it was $36 before we bought the Coke, so we just solved it backwards, which means 3 times what is 36? Well, you could say a 12 plus a 12 plus a 12 is 36. So there's your answer. All right? So the answer is 12, if you want to just picture it that way. Next slide. Carrie wants to put a gold-colored ribbon around her graduation certificate. The certificate is rectangular. It's 9 inches long. 2/3 of the length is what the width is equal to. How many inches of gold ribbon does she have to buy? All right, so of course, one smart thing to do is to draw the ribbon. Draw the plaque, rather. All right, so let's draw the plaque. Here we go. Let's pick a color. There's the plaque. And let's put some numbers on it, right? So she's going to put a plaque on there. The certificate is 9 inches long. All right, so 9 inches. And the width, let's call this the width. All right, the width, we'll call that the length. Who cares? Is 2/3 of. Of means multiply. All right, so what's 2/3 of 9? 9 times 2/3, so that's 2/3 of 9, or 9 times 2/3. And that's going to be, well, straight across the top is 18, straight across the bottom is 1, times 3 is 3. I'm thinking that's 6. Right, so it turns out it's 6. So you had to know how to multiply a bunch of fractions together. So 9 times 6 is, we're not doing area, are we? So we got 9 there, and 6 there, and 9 there, and 6 there. So this would be what you call the perimeter. So in perimeter, you add up the sides. We're not doing the area here. So you got a 9 and a 9. So you got 2 times a 9, and you're going to add up the edges there here. So 2 times a 6. So I'm thinking you got 18, and that's not a, you know, that's not what I said there. It's 2 times a 6, not a 16. I got to quit talking and doing it at the same time. So that'll be a 12. So it looks to me like you got 18 and 2 sixes. There you go. There, 30 inches, right? There's your answer. Okay, so we decided the gold, we decided there was 30 inches going around. So 30 inches. Around the perimeter of her plaque, and she's got to pay $3.15 per foot. $3.15 per foot. Well, this is inches. Oh man, how are you going to do this? Well, you could say, well, isn't $3.15 per foot, or $3.17 per foot rather, the same as $3.17 per 12 inches? Ah, see why showing your units helps? Look at that. Look how I've got everything in inches now. I can make the inches in the top, cancel the inches in the bottom. I'm left with the secret unit that everybody loves, money. And the survey says, so you do that on the calculator, what's 30 times 3.17? Let's go like that, 30 times 3.17, 3.17. I always miss the decimal, no, 3.17. And you end up with 95. Oh, and I still got to divide by 12. All right, I forgot to divide by 12. I was going, holy crap, that's pretty expensive ribbon. Divide by 12 is $7.93. All right, so $7.93. So she is going to pay $7.93 for the nice ribbon to put around her graduation certificate. Nice. Okay, here's Josh. He has 3 different little toy soldiers. How many ways can he arrange them in a line so that he can march off? All right, so let's see. He's got how many? He's got a bunch of toy soldiers. He could put this grenadier and this rifleman and this rifleman. He's got a submachine gun. And so he could go like that, or he could swap those two around and keep them tracked. So there's that, right? So there's 2 ways. So how about if we put him there, put him at tail end, right? So now he's at the front, so we've already had 2, so that's 3, so now that'll be 4. Now this guy here hasn't had a chance to actually be at the front, has he? Right? So we could put him there, and we could swap this, so there's 5, and I think then there's 6. You know what the smarter way to do this is? The smarter way is to do it this way, right? You could say, how many choices for the first place? How many choices for the second place? How many choices for the third place? There's three possibilities for that spot. So one of those three guys is going to go there. Then, how many choices are for the second spot? Well, there's two choices. So now you've had three Army guys. Now, two of them are already set down. There was three choices for there, two choices for there. There's only one guy left. So how many choices are there for the last guy? One. So three times two times one is six. Or you could have done a list. You could have said, well, we'll call him Albert and that Bruce and that Carl. So you could have said, well, we could do a list, Albert, Bruce, Carl, Albert, Carl, Bruce, right? Now, maybe it's Bruce's turn to be first. So Bruce, Albert, Carl. No, how about if Carl came in first there after Bruce? Bruce, Carl, Albert. Or maybe Carl gets to go first. He's point man, so we could have that. So you could have done it like this, too, and just made a list. All right, so that looks like that's the six different ways of doing it anyways. Anyway, that's called problem solving and making a list. And you'll do a lot more of this counting, fundamental counting in grade 12 applied math if you stay with me for that. Next slide. Well, this is a pretty popular question. The Canada Pension Plan. Don't confuse this with a company pension plan. And you know what? There are some adverts on TV that talk about the CPP, and they call themselves the CPP. They're trying to confuse you. All right, so you got to be careful. The Canada Pension Plan is a government plan that if you have a job, everybody puts money into this pot. So everybody puts their money into a pot. And then when you turn 65, then you can take money out of the pot. And it's designed to give you like 25 or 30% of your normal wage, right? So if you made $40,000 a year, it'll be $10,000 a year you get after you turn 65. Now, of course, they're thinking on changing that, but of course, you're going to have to put more money into the pot. So pretty soon, you're going to have to put more money into the pot. But then when you turn 65, if you live that long, you'll take more money out. So they're trying to get it up to about a third. So if you make $40,000 a year, you'll get $12,000 a year instead of just $10,000 a year. But you watch, they're going to start taking more money off your pay. Right now, they only take off about 5%. They're talking about making it like 8%. Anyway, so the CPP, the Canada Pension Plan, is a contributory plan to which workers pay a portion of their employment. Well, that's what it is. If you have a job, you pay 5% of your pay for 40 years or however long you work into this plan. Money goes in, and when you turn 65, you can take money out. If you never have a job, you won't get this. You'll get other stuff instead. But it's kind of nice having this CPP. It's a defined plan that's better than a pension from the city? No. All right. Turns out the... If you can get a pension from the government or from the city or from the province, oh my goodness, they get nice pensions, right? Mind you, they throw some money in, but then if you got a government pension plan, you throw your money in and the government throws some money in for you as well. So when you retire, you get the money you threw in plus some extra the government threw in or your boss. It's something that's been enjoyed by our progressive society for 100 years. No, that's wrong. They only started this Canada Pension Plan stuff in the 60s, right? Because I remember my grandma didn't know how old she was. And she kept writing letters to say, how old am I? Because I sure would like to get my money. So back in the 60s, a lot of older folks didn't really know exactly how old they were. But as soon as they started giving them money when they turned 65, they all of a sudden got a little bit interested in how old they were. And that's a true fact. I've actually got letters that my grandma wrote to the school board here in Gretna asking how old she was. It's a voluntary plan that can be declined using a T9 Charlie tax form. No, I just made that crap up. Right? You can't decline it. If you're going to have a job, you have to pay this money into the Canada Pension Plan. All right, there you go. Next slide. An example of a deduction. Deduction is something that comes off, right? A benefit is something that you get, all right? So there's a difference between a deduction, which comes off your pay, and a benefit, which is something you get, all right? So an example of a deduction from employment income is, right, they don't take off your CPP benefit. You get your benefit when you turn 65, so they don't take that off. A benefit is something that you get. So that's not the answer. Do they take off your child tax benefit? Do they take away $600 a month for every kid that you earn, that you have? No, they don't do that either. Right? The money you get for your Canada child benefit, that's a benefit that you get. It's not taken off your employment income. It's not even part of your employment income. Income taxes, there you go. The biggest chunk of your pay, of your income, well, your employment income at least, goes to taxes. Goods and services tax, no. GST and PST, they don't come off of your employment income. They come off when you spend the money, all right? So that's the type of tax that you pay when you spend the money. So you pay taxes when you earn money, and you pay taxes when you spend money, and then you pay taxes when you die, and other things like that, too. Jason goes to work at 8:45, leaves at 16:15, has an unpaid 45-minute lunch break. What duration of time does he get paid? So to some people, we call that 4:15 p.m., all right, for people that don't understand the proper 24-hour clock. Okay, so he finished work at 16:15 or 4:15 p.m. He went to work at 8:45. Now, don't forget, when you do time, you don't count by tens. It's not a metric system, I wish. It turns out it's just a sexagesimal system. Don't Google it, right? It's a 60s. You carry it 60s. So you go, okay, well, 15 take away 45. Oh, you can't do it. So you go to this guy here and you say, hey, can I borrow some minutes from you? He says, yeah. Well, here, tell you what. I'll loan you an hour. You cash that in for some minutes. So, of course, an hour, if you borrow from this guy, is 60 minutes. So now you've got your 15 plus the 60 he gave you. So 75 minus 45 is 30. And, of course, your buddy there loaned you that. So 15 minutes. So Jason's been at work for 7.5 hours. But guess what? Usually a boss doesn't pay you for your lunch break. So you still got to take away another 45. So you're going to subtract another 45 minutes, so 0 hours and 45 minutes, because you don't get paid for your lunch break normally. And you, oh my God, how am I going to do that? Well, would you believe that he's got to go borrow again? So what's 7:30? Take away 45. And of course, you got to go to your hour and you say, hey, hour, can I borrow some time from you? And he says, sure, I'll loan you an hour. And that means he gives you 60, added to your 30 makes 90. So now you got 6 hours and 90 minutes, which is really 7 hours and 30 minutes. And 90 minus 45 is 45. And, of course, you already borrowed the one. So he gets paid for 6 hours and 45 minutes of work. Right there. It's one of the answers. Obviously, this was a dumb answer. Okay, next slide. Triangles are important because, right now, we never did do the trigonometry unit, but we did look at triangles a little bit in Unit D. Every polygon can be made of triangles. There you go. 3 is a sacred number? No, I don't think we have religion. They are pointy and pretty. Yeah, I don't think that's the answer either. They always make a trapezoid when added to a rectangle. What the heck does that mean? That doesn't even make any sense to me. They always make a trapezoid when read at an angle. Right? Here's a rectangle. And if I add a, they always make a triangle when added to a rectangle. Right? So if I took a triangle and stuck it there, would that make a trapezoid? No. That's not a trapezoid. So it turns out that's a dumb answer too. So it turns out that was just to see if you could eliminate the dumb answers. And we talked about polygons. It's a three-sided figure. The sides are straight and it's got 3 sides, so it has 3 corners, so it's called a triangle. Next slide, the distributive law. Now this was grade 8 and 9. Maybe you got your yellow sheet and your red sheet out. But it turns out that the distributive law of arithmetic, you use it all the time. All right? You do. You use it all the time. Let's check it out. So, in the event you haven't done grade 8 or 9 in a long time, here's what the distributive law says, and we'll be doing more of this in grade 11 when we check out a little bit more algebra. But it turns out, check this out. Say I give you a flower and a chocolate bar. All right, say I put it in a package, right? I like to call parentheses packages. All right, so say I give you a flower and a chocolate bar today. And let's say I do that 4 days in a row. So four times I give you a flower and a chocolate bar. I put them in a package. So the question is, how many flowers did you get and how many chocolate bars did you get? Well, didn't you get four of those? And didn't you get four chocolate bars? I'm thinking you did. So there you go. It turns out if you get four packages, and each package has a flower and a chocolate bar in it, then you got four flowers and you got four chocolate bars. There, that's called the distributive law, because this four gets distributed to both objects there. So it turns out, well, this is dumb. This is the Pythagorean thing. This is dumb. Six squared, six times six is not 49. All right? Turns out that the only one, this one doesn't work either. Turns out here's what we're trying to say. If you have some number of B plus C, then you've got that number of B's and you've got that number of whatever the C is. So if you've got four packages of a flower and a chocolate bar, then you've got four chocolate bars, four flowers, and you have four chocolate bars. If you understand flowers and chocolate bars, you're good to go. That's called your distributive law. Next slide. 17 meters is the equivalent of, well, I hope you know 17 meters. That's pretty far, eh? That's like 55 feet or so. Guess what? 17, that's longer than our room. It's definitely, that's a dumb answer. It's not 5.18 feet. All right? And it's not 170 millimeters. And it's not 170 centimeters, because wouldn't this just be 1.7 meters? All right? So it turns out that it's none of those. So the only logical answer is that. Now, if you couldn't kind of see that because you didn't realize that, you know, this is the height of a person. And if you think that a person is 17 meters high, I'd like to meet that person. All right. So it turns out that this is the, all of these answers were dumb. So if you didn't, if you wanted to just check your answer, you could have said, well, 17, right, times, let's show the unit, 17 meters. And you're going to do the conversions, and you're going to say, let's see, I want to get rid of meters, and I do want feet. And you know that, well, first of all, you know it's going to be a bigger number of feet, because feet are smaller. So you know that, let's see, how many feet is the same as how many meters? If you look it up in your tables, which I'll always give you, I think it's 3.2808. Let's just try 3.28. Doesn't matter, because that's the only logical answer anyways. And when you get the plastic brain out, let's clear out all this crap here. 17 times 3.28. 3.28. Survey says 55.76. There you go. 55.76 what? 55.76 what? Let's see. Oh, yeah. We canceled out the meters and we're left with feet. Yeah. So that's all we know. We didn't screw it up. Nice. And here's another question just to see if you have a sense or reference for what things weigh. All right, so let's see. Does a car weigh 415 pounds? That'd be like two or three of your buddies. No, I think a car weighs more than two or three of your friends. 175 kilograms? Well, the average person's like 80, so does a car weigh the same as two or three people? Does two people? No, I don't think so. Does a car weigh 450 liters? Well, liters isn't a weight. It's just a volume, right? So guess what? You didn't have to do any math. The answer was that. The answer's 1,200 kilograms, which is kind of like about 2,500 pounds, which is kind of like about a ton and a bit. Yeah, tiny car, I guess. All right, so the other answers were dumb. So once you eliminate the dumb answers, the only answer that would work would be that one. It's just a test to see if you know a little bit of, you know, how much does stuff weigh? Oh, 1 1/4 plus 2 3/8 when properly reduced. Let's see what. Well, so this is fractions. Now, technically, you can use the fraction button on your calculator if you have one. But you know what? Fractions are not all that tough. So I'm saying 1 1/4 plus 2 3/8. Of course, you could always draw it, right? Quarters and eighths are pretty easy to do. Let's try that. Okay, so quarters and eighths are pretty easy, right? There's one whole birthday cake and a quarter of a birthday cake. So we call this one whole plus another quarter. We call that 1 1/4, right? There's a hidden plus in between there. And here you got two whole birthday cakes, so there's a one, and so we call two whole birthday cakes, so there's your whole numbers, and here will be your fraction part of your birthday cake, so it's broken into three pieces, and you got three of them left, right? So that's 3 out of 8. And then you go, okay, well, I got to add up my birthday cakes. So you got one, two, you got three whole birthday cakes. And you're going, oh, yeah, but you know what? These pieces are bigger than these pieces. So what you do is you go like that, and you say, okay, now they're all the same size pieces. So you've got 1 2/8 plus another 3/8. So all you did was you turned your quarters into 2/8. You found a common size slice and a 3/8. So you end up with 3 5/8. All right, so there's if you drew the pretty pictures. But you know what? It turns out that there's a secret way to do that. You'd say it's 1 1/4 plus 2 3/8. And then you got to find a greatest correction. Now you got to find the lowest common multiple. So what number can you make using fours that you can also make using eights? Well, I think you know that you can make 8 things with 2 fours. And guess what? You don't have to change this one. So you don't bother changing the whole bits. All you care about is the fraction bits. So this stays as 3/8. And I think you'll find out that 1 for 4, let's see. If I make it into twice as many slices, aren't they going to be smaller? So you're going to have twice as many. So if I multiply this by 2, I multiply this by 2. Turns out I just multiplied it by 2 over 2, which is 1. So 1/4 of a birthday cake is the same as 2 slices of an 8-slice birthday cake. 1 2/8. So now you can add the whole numbers, 1 and 2, and that is 3. And 2/8 and 3/8 is 5/8. So we'd say it's 3 5/8, which we just write as 3 5/8. And that's called fractions. Just use the fraction button on your calculator if you don't know how to do fractions. Don't be a tradesman if you can't do fractions, though. The length of side C. All right, so, the length of side C. Well, see, I made a boo-boo here. I meant to say the length of side B. Because normally you give the side across the little letter. All right, so I meant to say B. All right, the length of C we already knew is 7 yards, right? It was 7. All right, so that would have been called side C because little c is across from big corner C. So I suppose technically the answer to that is if I asked you for side C because I screwed up the question, you'd say, well, the answer is 7, right? But I meant to say side B. So it turns out you've got to know what B is, all right? So it turns out you use Pythagoras. You know that the long side squared all by itself is equal to the sum of the squares of the other two sides. So this would be side C, and this would be side A. Little a is across from big A, if you studied that unit. A squared plus C squared. See, it doesn't matter what you call the A and the C, as long as you realize the long side is by itself. Don't get sucked in because I called it B instead of C, like some teachers do. All right, I don't care what you call them, as long as you understand that this is the long side all by itself. So it turns out the B squared is going to equal, well, isn't 7 squared 49? And isn't another 7 squared really another 49? So the B squared equals 98. So this is all Pythagoras. So you end up with the B is going to be the square root of 98, and I think you'll find out that means 9.9. So it's 9.9 yards. That's the closest answer. All right, so I messed up that question. I meant to say B. Notice when I say it's not to scale, that's because this length is not the same as that. I'm telling you they're the same length. But you can look at it and say they don't look like the jet. If they're not to scale, it doesn't have to look right. I just wing a triangle down and fling numbers on it, and we're good to go. Next slide. Circumference of the circle. Well, I hope you know the circumference of the circle is kind of like 3 and a bit times the distance across. All right, or you could say, well, this is the radius, right? That's an R. So there's another, another formula. It's the same formula. You could say that 2 radiuses is the same as 1 diameter, and then you put the pi in between there. Normally, you like to put numbers in front of letters. You know, like I have 3 cows. You don't say I have cows 3. So let's use that formula. So the C is going to be 2 times pi, and I don't care whether you use real pi or 3.14 or whatever, and times the 8. So that looks like it's going to be, well, look, 2 times 8 is 16 times the pi. Hey, it's 16 pi, and it's exact. Nice. So there you go. It's exactly 16 pi. If you tried to multiply that out, you'd find out that it was, yeah, it came pretty close to 50, right? So if you did 16 times pi, what would you end up with? I'll use the real pi on my calculator, of course. 16 times pi. Let's clear this out. 16 times pi, or pi times 16. Survey set. Whoops. What have I done there? Second function. Boom. 50.27. 50.27. But of course, don't forget, nobody knows what pi really, really, really is, so I would put a squiggle there. So since I said it was exactly 16 pi's, the fact that nobody knows what a pi is worth is kind of inconsequential. There's the best answer. This one's damn close, but this is the best answer. Next slide. 57 inches is how many feet in inches? All right, so how many 12s go into a 57? I'm starting to get tired of this. It's going to be awful darn close to 5 feet, isn't it? 12 goes into 57 how many times? How about 4? 4 12s, that'd be 48, and there'd be 9 left over. And so that means you can quit there, so it's going to be a remainder of 9. So what you got is 4 feet. 4 12s would be 4 feet. And you got 9 left over. That's the leftover is what you call the inches. 4 foot 9 right there. And we use that for feet and that for inches. Sweet. 4.95% of 630 is, well, this is dumb. What the hell does that, what the heck does that mean? And clearly, it's going to be a small part. It's going to be 4.95 parts out of 100 of 630. So clearly, that's wrong. And you know what? This is like 5, if you round this, this is like 5% of 630. So clearly it's not going to be more. So it turns out that that's dumb. And that's even dumber. And that's, right, it's got to be a number that's smaller than 630 if you're doing 5 parts out of 100 of 630. Turns out you didn't even have to do the math. There's the answer there. All right, so there's another good example of eliminate the dumb answers, and what's left over is the best choice. And if you're lucky, you'll be down to 2 choices. You could just guess. You could still pass a multiple choice without even knowing what you're doing. Hardly. 6 plus 4 squared minus 7. We did a bit of this. Don't forget you do bed mass, or ped mass, as some people call it. Right? You do what's in parentheses or brackets first. Then you do your exponents next. There's an exponent. And then you do your multiplying, dividing, and your adding and subtracting left to right. So you got 6. You do that first is 16 minus 7. That looks like about 22 minus 7. The answer is 15. Next slide. Half the length of a board measures 7 foot 9 inches in length. So 7 foot 9 inches. Your boss tells you to chop a 7 foot 9 inch board in half. How long is each half? So first of all, it makes it a heck of a lot easier if you know that 7 feet and 9 inches is the same as 7 feet and 9 twelfths of a foot. So let's turn everything into feet, and then we don't have to mix feet and inches the way we used to do it in the old days. So what you've really got is 7 and 9 twelfths of a foot. All right, because we don't do things in the decimal system. That's why it's per 12. All right, so now you got 7 and 9 twelfths of a foot. This is one way to do it. And you're going to multiply that by 1 half. Isn't that what taking a half of something is? So remember how to do fractions. What's 7 times 12? Isn't that 84 and 9? 84 and 9 is 93 twelfths, I think. Times 1 half. And you know how to multiply straight across the top. Straight. Use your button. Put that in your calculator, for goodness sake. If you don't know how to do fractions, the top is 93. The bottom is 24. How many 24s that are in a 93? Let me see. About 6. No, that's too many. 5. No. How about 4? No. 4. Oh, almost 4. Darn. So 3. So 3 24s would be 72, and there'd be, yeah, so 24, 3 24s would be 72, and then there'd be 21 left over. So there'd be 21 24ths. So the answer is 3 and 21 24ths. But guess what? We don't break boards into 24ths. We break them into 12ths, feet into 12ths. So you'd say, well, this was 3, and right, you're going to break it into 12ths. So half of 21 is 10 and a half 12ths, which is what we call 10 and a half inches. So it turns out the answer is 3 feet. And 10 and a half 12ths, which is what we call 10 and a half inches. Right, so there's one way to do it. That's just a test to see if you know what fractions are all about. If you're going to be a carpenter, you're going to want to know how to do that. So the answer is right there, 3 foot, 10 and a half. You know what? All you had to really do was reverse calculate. 4 plus 4 would be 8, so that was wrong. 3.95, so this one would be wrong to start with, because 4 plus another 4 would be 8. That's too long. So you could have added instead. You could have said, well, I got 3 feet. 10 and a half inches. So you could have just tested this answer to see which one worked. Plus another 3 feet, 10 and a half inches. So you could have reverse engineered this or back solving. So 10 and a half and 10 and a half would be 21 inches. And 3 would be 6 feet. This is inches. This is feet. And then you'd say, well, hold on, the first 12 inches is really another foot. So you'd say it was 7 foot, and that would leave 9 inches left over. So, yeah, you could have done it that way by back solving, by just picking each answer and doubling each one times 2. Add it to itself. Anyway, there's one way to solve that. I'm sure there'll be others. Fractions are fun. Mike's going to paint one wall in his bedroom. The wall is 8 feet high and 12 feet wide, so 8 feet high. 8 feet high, 12 feet wide, all right, 12 feet. The window measures 3 feet by 5 feet in the wall. So there's a window, 3 feet by 5 feet. This is obviously not the scale. I'm just whipping numbers down there. How much area of the wall does he have to paint? Now, when you paint your wall, you're not going to paint the window, are you? So all you really got to do is paint the wall. If you put paint on the window, somebody's going to get a little bit upset with you, all right? So it turns out you'd go, well, hold on, the whole wall itself, including the window, would be have an area of 8 times 12. So the area of that rectangular wall would be 8 times 12 is going to equal, what's that? 8 times and 16 is going to be 96 square feet. That's kind of like a standard size wall in a bedroom. And, oh, but you're not going to paint that. And how big is that? That's 15 square feet, isn't it? Right, so you're going to subtract the 3 by 5, so you're going to subtract the 15 square feet, unless you really feel like painting your window. So you're going to have 81 square feet to cover. And usually it says on the can that this can will cover 94 square feet or something. So when you buy a can of paint, it tells you how many it'll cover. So there you go. There's the answer there. Obviously, this answer was dumb because area is not measured in lengths, area is measured in squares. So this was dumb. Don't go picking the answer where the units are mucked up. All right, Wanda's painting a wall in her bedroom. The wall's 3 meters long and 2.7 meters high. And she has a window on that wall that measures. Now we're doing the metric system. Oh, you gotta love the metric system. Let's draw this sucker. There, I just went offline and drew it for you. So it's 3 meters that way, her wall, 2.7 meters high. That's kind of like standard. And her window is 80 centimeters by 60 centimeters. Notice I wrote down the units. And as I'm doing that, I'm going, uh-oh, we have a problem, Houston. Look how some of the measurements are in meters and some of the measurements are in square centimeters. We're going to want to kind of work in all the same units. You can't add apples to oranges. So I hope you know that 80 centimeters is 0.8 meters. Right? You could do a little conversion there. And I hope you know that 60 centimeters, 61 hundredths of a meter, is really 0.6 meters. Ah, now everything is in meters. Now when we do our adding and subtractings, we'll be working the same kind of units. All right, so let's figure out what area of wall does Wanda have to paint. All right, so the area that she's going to paint, well, what's the whole wall? Pretend the window's not there. All right, so if the window's not there, it's going to be 3 times 2.7. Can you do that in your head? That looks like about 8.1. 8.1 square meters. What area of wall does she have to do? Well, hold on. Now we got to take away the window, because you're not going to take away the window. So that was the area of the wall total. Now we're going to subtract the window. And don't forget, now we got all that. This is why you keep track of the units. So the window is 0.8 times 0.6, 0.6 meters times 0.8 meters. And I think you'll find out that's really the same as 0.48. 48 one-hundredths of a meter squared. So when you do all that subtracting, because it's a subtract, you're not going to paint the window, you end up with 7.62 square meters. So she would go buy a can of paint that says that this can of paint covers, whatever, more than 7.62 square meters, right? Well, this would be dumb. Who the heck would measure their wall in little tiny square centimeters? I mean, that's a baby fingernail, for God's sake. And this is wrong. Look, there's not even any units on that one. All right, so you were kind of stuck with those two. All right, next slide. Here, the area of this triangle. Well, I hope you know the area of a triangle by now. An area of a triangle is, the area is equal to 1/2 of the base times the height. And it's really just half of a parallelogram or half of a rectangle. So there's your base is 5. There's your height is, don't forget, height is always measured square on to something. There's a 5. There's a 4. That's a centimeter. That's a centimeter. It helps if you keep track of your units. Make sure I'm not fooling with you and making one a meter and one a centimeter. So it turns out the area is going to be half of 4 is 2 times 5. You don't need a calculator for that. It's going to be 10. Centimeter squared. So there's your answer there. Clearly this one was dumb, because that's the wrong units, right? You got to have a square in there. And yeah, this would have been if it was a full rectangle. If it was a full rectangle, it would have been 20. But it's not a full rectangle. It's half of a rectangle, all right? So that was kind of dumb. So yeah, there's the answer, 10. The area of this circle. What's the area of a circle? Well, here's the formula for the area of a circle. The area of a circle is pi times the radius squared, right? You would always have that. You would always write down the formula first. You write down the formula. That way you know what you got to plug in. So the area of this circle is, let's just use the real pi on our calculator like we were told to do. Now, R, don't forget, this is the D. So you want the R. Isn't the radius, if you radiate from the center, going to be half as much? So that'll be 5 meters. So now you know you got 5 meters all squared. So now you know you've got that. You put that into your plastic brain. You've got a meter, which is a meter squared. So you're going to have 25 times pi. Let's get our plastic brain to do that. Let's do pi times, why do I keep doing that? Oh, wrong button. All right, clear. Let's do pi times 5 squared. Boom. And survey says 78.54. So 78.54 square meters. All right, so I'm thinking, you know what? If you rounded that, it would be that, because I said to pick the closest answer. Obviously, this one was wrong, because you can't measure areas in lengths. A length is not an area. You need two dimensions to make an area. So there's your answer there. Show your work, write down the formula, then plug in the numbers, then do the, if all you do is grab the calculator and start smacking numbers in, you're bound to forget the square, or you're bound to forget that it's an R, not a D. Write down the formula. There's only one formula. Write down the formula. Plug in the numbers. Then you pick up the calculator. Do not write anything into the calculator until you know exactly what is really supposed to go in there. I know some of you won't listen to me. The measure of this angle. Okay, so it turns out we may not have got to this unit. This is called trigonometry. All right, so our ancients, like, 3,000 years ago, figured out how to measure how pointy a corner is. So if you want to know how pointy a corner is, measured in degrees, right? It turns out that they measured every possible triangle 3,000 years ago when they were making the pyramids, and they said, so for every triangle where this side is 5 compared to that side, well, what's 5 divided by 10? 5 divided by 10 is what you Earth people call 0.5. So, we're going to look in, it's called a tangent. When you compare this side with this side, it's called a tangent. 0.5 is somewhere probably halfway in between. So it turns out our ancients figured out that any triangle, it's probably about halfway in between, any triangle where this side is half as long as this, then that corner there, well, any square triangle, then that corner there has to be about 26.5 degrees. All right? So that way you didn't have to always measure things. All right, so it turns out, let's get the plastic brain to do it. So maybe you remember how to do this. It turns out there's a secret formula that we figured out 3,000 years ago, and it's called the UN-10. All right, so we say that if you want to know the angle, so corner A, if you want to know the measure of corner A as an angle, you say it's the UN-10. So the UN-10 of 0.5. And there's a button on your calculator that does that. Right? You have this huge table here, and you may not have got to this unit. We'll be doing a lot more of this in grade 11, though. So the angle is, and you use this, see that? There's the UN-10 button there. All right, so you do the UN-10 of 0.5. And your calculator says it's 26.6 degrees right there. All right, you see that? 26.6. So that's called trigonometry. When you start measuring angles, when you start using the knowledge we figured out thousands of years ago, that any triangle where this is a 5 and this is a 10, if that's a square corner, that's got to be a 26.6 degree angle. All right, so that's called trigonometry. Trigonometry means the measure of three-sided things. Weird, eh? Greatest common factor, the GCF. All right, so you needed the GCF to do the fractions, all right? You needed GCF. You needed GCF to make like fractions. All right, so the greatest common factor of 56 and 49, all right? 56 and 49. So remember what a factor is? A factor is a number that you can multiply to make another number. So I can make 56 ones. So 56 ones would make a 56. So how about 2s? Oh, yeah, it's an even number, so 2 would work. So 28 2s would work. So I can use 28s to make a 56. I can use 2s to make a 56. Can I use 3s? Does 3 go into 56? It does, actually, you know. All right. Oh, no, it doesn't. I'm sorry. My apologies. It does not. How about 4s? Does 4 go into 56? Yeah, it does. Check this out. Right? Because 4 times 14 would be 56. All right. How about 6s? No. How about 7s? Oh, yeah, 7 works. 7 times 8 is 56. So it turns out the different size packages you can use to make a 56 are those. All right, now what size packages can you use to make a 49? Let's see, there's a 1. Does a 2 work? No. Does a 3 work? No. Does a 4 work? 4 times something is? No. Does a 5? No. Does a 6 work? No. Does a 7? Oh, 7 works. 7 times 7. Oh, guess what? There's your answers. All right, so there's only those numbers there that you can use to make a 49. So what is the greatest common factor? There it is right there. The greatest common factor is 7. So the GCF of this is 7. And you need that for doing fractions. Yep, so you need that to reduce your fractions a little bit. Okay, so if you had like 49/56, you could use your GCF, your greatest common factor, reduce them. Because didn't we agree that 49 was really 7 sevens? And didn't we just finish saying you could make 56 with 8 sevens? And isn't the 7 divided by the 7 1? So it turns out that 49/56 is the same as 7/8. That's why it's kind of nice to know the GCF. chances, but of course, you know what? You got a button on your calculator that does it too. If you got a button on your calculator that does fractions, that works too, right? I could go 49 divided by 56. This computer has it. And then I just go math, convert to a fraction, boom, boom, and it tells me it's 7/8. So there's a button on a computer or a calculator or your app or whatever that does that, right? So 7/8 is, that's why you learn the GCF, so you can reduce fractions, right? Lowest common multiple. You need lowest common multiple so that you can add and subtract fractions. All right, so let's do 8 and 12. What is the lowest common multiple of 8 and 12? In other words, what size packages can you make using an 8 and 12? See, here we are finding what was the biggest package you could use to make a number. Now we're saying what size packages can you make using that number. All right, are you paying attention here? Right, so you could have 8. Or you could have two of them, it'd be 16. Or you could have 3 8s, it'd be 24. Or another 8 would be 32. Or another 8, it'd be 40. And another 8, it'd be 48, etc. All right, you got it? All right, can you see kind of a pattern here? We're just going to keep going. And how about 12s? Yeah, so you could have a dozen. You could have two dozen. You could have three dozen. Right, you could have, so we're looking for the lowest common multiple. So it turns out this is handy for when you're adding and subtracting fractions. So the lowest common multiple, what's common? 48s are common. 24s are common. And that's about it. So it turns out the 24 is the LCM. And you need that when you're adding and subtracting fractions. All right. So if I said what is 3 8ths plus 5 12ths, well, that's why you need the common multiple. You could say, well, 3 8ths is the same as, let's see, if we make break everything into 24ths, right, you'd say, well, hold on, I'm going to have three times as many, aren't I? So you're going to have 9 24ths. So 9 slices of a 24-slice pizza is the same as 3 slices of an 8-slice pizza. And since I doubled the number of pieces here, I'm going to have twice as many there. They're smaller pieces, but you got twice as many. So you're going to end up with 1924. So that's why you learn how to do an LCM, a lowest common multiple, also known as a lowest common denominator. And we'll be doing much more of that in grade 11. You got to kind of know fractions, technically speaking. All right, so there we go. I kind of raced through all that because this was getting a little long and drawn out. Well, I hope that worked for you. Briefing is complete.